Truman Capote, the renowned American author, is widely remembered for his literary masterpiece, In Cold Blood. However, it was not only his writing prowess that pushed him to the top of literary charts and high society. Capote had a unique ability to charm and befriend a circle of high society women who he dubbed his swans. These women, with their style, wealth, and connections, epitomized the glamour and sophistication of high society in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s. But behind the scenes of this thoroughly enthralling social scene lurked a story of ambition, betrayal, and shattered friendships. The 2024 FX show Feud, Capote vs. the Swans, portrays the complex dynamics between Truman Capote and his anointed swans. Set against the backdrop of the fashionable world of New York society, the show unveils the scandal-filled sophistication of Manhattan's upper echelon in the context of Capote's narcissistic need for affirmation and attention, which ultimately led to the writer's downfall. Welcome to our channel, where we bring you the real and true history behind popular TV shows and movies, past and present. In this video, we will look at the historical account of who Truman Capote was, how his life events compelled him to betray the women he befriended, and uncover exactly what happened that culminated in the vehement feud that destroyed his career. Born in 1924 in New Orleans, Truman Capote had a tumultuous childhood marked by his parents' separation. Raised by relatives in Monroeville, Alabama, Capote rose above a childhood troubled by divorce, a long absence from his mother, and multiple migrations. As a lonely child, Capote taught himself to read and write before he entered his first year of school. He had never wavered from his calling as a writer, and he honed his writing ability throughout his childhood. Capote was often seen at age 5, carrying his dictionary and notepad, and began writing fiction at age 11. On Saturdays, he made trips from Monroeville to the nearby city of Mobile on the Gulf Coast, and at one point submitted a short story called Old Mrs. Busybody to a children's writing contest sponsored by the Mobile Press Register. Of his early days, Capote once stated in an interview,
"I was writing really sort of serious when I was about 11. I say seriously in the sense that, like other kids, go home and practice the violin or the piano or whatever. I used to go home from school every day and I would write for about 3 hours. I was obsessed by it."
In 1932, he attended the Trinity School in New York City. He then attended St. Joseph Military Academy. In 1939, the Capote family moved to Greenwich, Connecticut, and Truman attended Greenwich High School, where he wrote for both the school's literary journal and the school newspaper. When they returned to New York City in 1941, he attended Franklin Public School, then an Upper West Side private school now known as the Dwight School, where he graduated in 1942. That was the end of his formal education. In his last year of school, he began his professional career at age 17, writing short stories for the New Yorker magazine. Between 1943 and 1946, Truman Capote wrote a continual flow of short fiction. His stories were published in both literary quarterlies and well-known popular magazines, including The Atlantic Monthly, Harper's Bazaar, Mademoiselle, The New Yorker, Prairie Schooner, and Story Magazine. In June 1945, the short story, Miriam, was published by Mademoiselle Magazine and went on to win a prize, Best First Published Story, in 1946. The critical success of Miriam attracted the attention of Random House Publishing and resulted in a contract to write Capote's first published novel entitled Other Voices, Other Rooms. The semi-autobiographical novel of Truman's childhood focuses on a lonely, effeminate 13-year-old New Orleans boy who is sent to live with his father in rural Alabama after his mother dies. Gaining critical acclaim and notoriety for its groundbreaking homoerotic themes, the promotion and controversy surrounding Other Voices, Other Rooms became Capote's entrance into the world of fame and recognition, something that he craved and nurtured his entire life. Starting with the erotically charged photograph of the young author on the back of his first novel, Truman went to great lengths to remain in the spotlight at all costs. In essence, He was an insecure gay man that needed motherly love and attention while at the same time had a deeply hidden jealousy of the charm, beauty, and grace of the women who he secretly feared would someday abandon him, just as his mother had. Capote went on to boost his fame with Breakfast at Tiffany's, published in 1958, and adapted for the screen in 1962 to critical and commercial success. But it was In Cold Blood, a journalistic work about the murder of a Kansas farm family in their home, published in 1966, that catapulted the author to the pinnacle of fame he so desperately craved. Continually sought after, Capote entrenched himself more deeply in the world of the New York jet set, becoming best friends with his bevy of swans who would share their most intimate thoughts, feelings, and secrets to the man who would cruelly and without remorse ultimately betray them. Now that you know who Truman Capote was and the psychology behind the man, it's time to move on to exactly what happened that brought Capote to his knees and fractured the lives of the women who had so naively trusted him. Truman Capote's swans were a constellation of the most dazzling stars in the firmament of New York's high society. The swans included Babe Paley, aka Barbara Cushing Mortimer Paley, wife of CBS founder William S. Paley. Nancy Slim Keith, or simply Slim Keith, socialite and former wife of film director Howard Hawks. Marella Agnelli, Italian aristocrat and wife of Fiat chairman Johnny Agnelli. Gloria Guinness, socialite and fashion icon. C.Z. Guest, American actress, author, columnist, horsewoman, fashion designer, and socialite. By the mid-60s, Capote had had two decades to explore the deepest recesses of their lives, two decades to listen to their secrets, two decades to deeply understand them. He had everything he needed to write about them with depth and nuance, exploring both the good and the bad, the light and the darkness. On January 5th, 1966, Capote signed a contract with Random House to write a novel called Answered Prayers. Random House gave Capote an advance of $25,000, and the contract stipulated that the completed manuscript would be delivered by January 1, 1968. When he began working on Answered Prayers, Capote predicted that it would be his magnum opus, his great work capturing the essence of the society he was oh so intimately familiar with, the high society of New York in the mid-20th century, and the women of wealth, sophistication, and social prowess who populated it. But as time went on, Capote missed his original deadline. He negotiated a larger advance for a later deadline. The deadline date kept moving, and Capote kept getting more and larger advances, something that Random House Publishing was beginning to grumble about. So after missing those first paid deadlines, Capote decided to publish a few chapters of Answered Prayers in magazines, just to prove to Random House that he was indeed still working on the book. The first published chapter, titled Mojave, appeared in the June 1975 issue of Esquire, but the one that really caught people's attention was La Côte Basque 1965, which appeared in the November 1975 edition of Esquire. While Mojave was well-received by readers, and even Tennessee Williams sent a compliment to Capote, La Côte Basque 1965 proved to be so controversial that it would ultimately become Capote's undoing. Set in a real French restaurant in New York City, La Côte Basque 1965 sees the novel's narrator, P.B. Jones, meeting with his friend, Lady Ina Coolberth, to gossip about their high society cohorts. What followed was a series of scandalous, thinly veiled revelations about all of Capote's rich, well-connected friends. He changed all their names, but it was obvious who he was writing about. Lady Coolberth was a stand-in for Slim Keith, although Terman disputed this claim, but even Keith herself was sure the character was based on her. Babe Paley and her adulterous husband William were portrayed as Cleo Dillon and her adulterous husband Sidney, detailing all of the real-life William's infidelities. The most notorious part of the chapter includes a fictionalized version of a real-life homicide case that actually did happen within their jet-set circle. In 1955, the real-life businessman William Woodward was shot by his wife Anne in their home. Anne claimed she mistook her husband for an intruder, but a rumor suggested that she killed him intentionally. Truman Capote took that rumor and ran with it, creating a character named David Hopkins, murdered by his wife Anne. Capote didn't even change the wife's name. Just before the chapter was published in Esquire, Anne took her own life. No reason was given, but some people, including Woodward's mother, thought she had advance warning of Capote's story. As soon as La Côte Basque 1965 was published in Esquire, Truman Capote was cut off from his high society social circle and all his wealthy friends turned their backs on him. According to gossip columnist Liz Smith, New York's high society discussions were immediately filled with vitriol towards Capote, with some calling for revenge. Most of Capote's socialite friends, including Slim Keith, refused to ever speak to him again. Capote was reported to be particularly upset about losing Babe Paley's friendship. One report claims that Capote was crying in his house after his friends cut ties with him. He didn't expect such a ferocious response.
I didn't mean to. I thought they'd come back.
So, why did Truman Capote sabotage his closest friendships and turn the most powerful people in New York against him? According to psychologist Carolyn Mayer, when Capote first started hanging around with New York City's wealthy socialites, he initially craved acceptance. But she felt that as time went on and he got closer to these ultra-rich people, he grew to resent the elite world he'd managed to infiltrate. Mayer believes that Capote's uncanny ability to recollect entire conversations word for word made him a perfect source of gossip. Anyone who pried Capote for scandalous gossip about their closest friends revealed their ugliness to him, and he felt the need to document and expose that ugliness. As Truman Capote's mental issues worsened, Mayer theorizes, his judgment of the people around him also soured. The completed manuscript of Answered Prayers was never found and may never have existed. And I'll go deeper into that mystery a little later on. For now, let's turn to Capote's relationship with his mother to see how it colored everything he did in life, including his decision to expose their secrets for all the world to see. She was born Lily Mae Falk in Monroeville, Alabama, on January 19, 1905. Despite being born into poverty, only to be orphaned soon after and left to live with relatives, Lily Mae harbored aspirations far grander than anything found in rural Alabama. In 1923, escape came in the form of 25-year-old Arch Persons, a fast-talking ladies' man whose two biggest assets were his beguiling charm and a flashy sports car. Dazzled by both, Lily Mae imagined driving off to the big cities of her dreams with her Prince Charming by her side. Her wish had come true, or so she thought, when she and Arch married impulsively soon after they met, and they set off on a grand honeymoon. 2 weeks into the honeymoon, Nina discovered that Arch had no money, and that in fact, he had no means to afford any kind of lifestyle at all. Nina raged against his deception so much so that Arch sent his new bride back to her relatives in Monroeville post-haste. Nina set her mind on divorcing Arch and planning a new escape with the help of her budding beauty and an awakened libido, but alas, she soon discovered she was pregnant. For a time, she contemplated abortion, but when she learned that Arch was living in New Orleans, she decided her best hope was to reconcile and go to live with him there, just so long as it was far away from the dull country life of Monroeville. On September 30th, 1924, Lily Mae gave birth to Truman Streckfuss Persons, a beautiful, blonde, doll-like infant, hoping that a son would somehow change Arch from a smooth-talking con man who couldn't hold a job into a refined man of wealth who could give her stability and social status. Once again, her dreams dissipated as she and Arch took to living in a series of hotel rooms across America in pursuit of his dismal, get-rich-quick schemes. For the first 6 years of his life, Truman Capote found himself in one hotel room after another, where he was either locked away unattended while his parents were out for the night, or he was trapped in the room with his promiscuous mother and the many men who would visit her bed while Arch was away. This time of abandonment and neglect set the tone for Truman's early childhood. He suffered this upsetting itinerant life until Lily Mae, replicating her own childhood, abruptly deposited her only child with her sisters still living in Monroeville. She was a social climber, propelled by unrealistic aspirations with a failure of a husband and a demanding child who would only get in her way. According to the Capote biographer Gerald Clark, Lily Mae would occasionally visit from some distant place dressed in stylish, expensive clothes, creating an air of excitement and envious glances from her friends. But soon, she would disappear in a fragrant cloud of Evening in Paris, her favorite perfume. Truman was always desolate when she drove off. Clark recounted, "Once, finding a perfume bottle she had forgotten, he drank it to the bottom, as if he could keep her essence deep inside himself." Truman told Clark what it felt like for him as a young boy to see her go.
"On one visit, I convinced myself that she was going to take me away with her. But after 3 or 4 days, she left. And I stood in the road watching her drive away in a big black Buick, which got smaller and smaller and smaller. Imagine a dog watching and waiting and hoping to be taken away. That is the picture of me then."
In 1932, Lily Mae, now Nina, met a Cuban Wall Street broker named Joseph Capote and married him soon after. It took her almost a year to get Truman out of Monroeville and to New York, even though she'd easily won his custody. By 1935, Joe adopted Truman as his own, thereby giving him what would become the infamous name of Truman Capote. Her marriage to Joe brought Nina almost everything she'd dreamed of, and she lived lavishly. First, the family lived in Manhattan, then briefly moved to Greenwich in Connecticut, and then returned to New York, where Nina got to finally live on the coveted Park Avenue. But Nina was a woman who could never feel settled, living in the shadow of her own childhood abandonment and constantly battling feelings of inadequacy while segments of New York society rejected her, even though she did her best to fit in. Which brings us to how Truman's childhood and his relationship with his mother led him to betray his women friends, the Swans.
"What did I do for you exactly?"
"You avenged me, of course. All those people that had no time for me. Those women of New York society. Just like your Swans. You knew how I felt. So you took them out, didn't you? And you did it so brilliantly, with such surgical precision. With so much deep hatred."
Truman loved his mother, but deep down, he also hated his mother. He resented her for abandoning him over and over again. And he loved his New York society women, his Swans, but ultimately he came to resent them as well. For 2 decades, he had listened to their secrets, their deepest feelings, their unfulfilled desires. And then one day, he decided to publish excerpts from a new book he was working on that revealed their secrets. Like his mother, the Swans were beautiful but broken. Like his mother, the Swans never felt secure no matter the riches their husbands provided. Their insecurities lay in their inabilities to keep their philandering husbands close to home. To be loved unconditionally, to feel as though they had value that went beyond appearances. And just like his mother, many of the Swans were not good mothers to their children. In a sense, one could say that Babe Paley, his favorite and most loved Swan, was essentially a stand-in for his mother. Babe Paley poured her heart out to Truman and he took it all in. Like the sin eater who ate the sins of others so they could be absolved from their sins and garner some peace in the world, Truman absorbed the fears and anxieties of Babe. She was his confidant and he was her empathetic therapist. If Truman Capote's childhood taught him anything, it was that any minute the winds could shift and no matter how hard he tried, no matter what he had to offer, she could, and most probably would, leave him someday. But still, from within his deep-seated yearning for maternal affection and acceptance, he offered them a shoulder to cry on, and he kept doing this over and over again, through the years, not only with Babe, but with several others. Truman Capote lived in constant fear that one day Babe and the others would walk away and forget all he had done for them. So he took matters in his own hand and he betrayed them. He exposed their inner worlds through the use of thinly veiled characters in La Côte Basque 1965. When it was published, Babe rejected Truman completely. She cast him aside, as did most of his other swans, ousting him out of their high society circle and refusing to let him back in. Babe died of cancer just shy of 3 years later, having never spoken to him again. By this time, Capote's mother had already left him one final time when she committed suicide. It was her one final act of abandonment. On January 4, 1954, Nina Capote died at the age of 48 from an overdose of sleeping pills. She ended up back in her hometown of Monroeville in Baptist Cemetery. 2 years before her death, Joe Capote had been caught embezzling money from his place of employment. Nina lost the money that upheld any of the status she had been able to achieve, no matter how tenuous. Once again, she was about to face rejection from New York's high society. Those women who were just like Truman's swans. The bricks of her world had come tumbling down, and Lily May wasn't strong enough to bear it. Next, we'll look at Truman Capote's most beloved swan, Babe Paley, and the tragedy of her marriage that Capote exposed when he published La Côte Basque 1965 as an excerpt of his unfinished novel, Answered Prayers. She was a fashion icon in mid-century New York high society. He was a media mogul with wealth, power, and charisma. She was tall, beautiful, and gracious, one of the most admired women of the 20th century. He was cold, stern, and known to have a bad temper. The two couldn't have been more different in personality and presentation, yet they would marry each other for similar reasons. In this video, we take a deep dive into the tragic marriage of Truman Capote's favorite swan, Babe Paley, to William S. Paley, the Chicago cigar maker's son who built the CBS television empire and reigned as its autocratic chairman until 1983. We'll look at what is true and what may not be true inside the marriage of this mid-century New York power couple. Let's begin. Barbara Babe Cushing married Bill Paley on July 28, 1947. She was 32 years old, just divorced from an alcoholic husband, while Bill was over a decade her senior at 45. He too was fresh from a divorce. In fact, Bill Paley married Babe just 4 days after his divorce was final. The first question that comes to mind is, why did they marry each other? Was it love, or was it something darker, more transactional? The two grew up in different social strata. Babe's father was an esteemed surgeon born and bred in an affluent family married to a prominent Boston socialite. Bill, on the other hand, was a second-generation Ukrainian Jew whose father made his fortune by running a cigar company. They both came from money and had money when they married, but it wasn't money they were after. For both Bill and Babe, the drive was to climb up the social ladder of high society New York to reach its pinnacle, where influence, recognition, and power were not just the ultimate symbols of status, but, for Bill, also the keys to unlocking doors that had once seemed impenetrable to him. Babe was already an established member of New York's high society, but Bill was not. He lacked culture and refinement. That is, until he married his first wife, the glamorous Dorothy Hart Hershen, whose first husband was John Randolph Hearst of the Hearst Empire. Sally Bedell Smith wrote In All His Glory, her 1990 biography of Bill Paley. Although 7 years his junior, Dorothy was more worldly than he. She knew her way around sophisticated circles. Friendships with men like Randolph Churchill counted a great deal to the ambitious Paley. In New York, she joined the Algonquin Set, the playwrights, journalists, and other intellectuals whose luncheon riposts during the 1920s became a literary legend. Dorothy became his Pygmalion. His hunger to know satisfied her trenchant desire to teach. He had the instincts, but she had the knowledge. She began transforming his life. She got him to Savile Row tailors. She encouraged him to buy art and introduced him to dealers. In a short time, they began to accumulate what is now known as the William Paley Collection of Art. Dorothy may have been worldly and sophisticated, but one thing she wasn't was a docile, doting wife. She once recalled about her marriage to Paley, "I never behaved as if the world revolved around him. Maybe that was a problem." Enter Babe Paley, another younger woman who Bill Paley could use to his advantage. Babe gave Bill entry to a level of high society and elevated taste, and Bill provided Babe with all the money she could ever need so that she could live the way she and her mother believed she was born to live. Babe's mother, Catherine Stone Crowell Cushing, practiced the fine art of grooming her three daughters, Mary, Betsy, and Babe, collectively known as the Fabulous Cushing Sisters, to marry the richest and most distinguished men in America. Mary's first husband was William Vincent Astor of the prestigious Old Money Astor family of New York, and Betsy first married James Roosevelt II, and later, Jock Whitney, the millionaire sportsman and publisher. When Babe met William Paley, his wealth was already impressive. In 1946, his holdings in CBS alone were worth $9.8 million, and his income from salary and dividends that year exceeded $800,000. Babe was a WASP, a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, and an established member of what was coined the Cafe Society. They were the beautiful people and bright young things. The set of people who tended to do their entertaining semi-publicly and who gathered in fashionable cafes and restaurants in New York, Paris, and London. Bill needed Babe to offset his Jewish background and boost his status in the New York Cafe Society, and Babe wanted a man who fit the requirements that her mother, Catherine, had raised her to expect. When they married, one newspaper account of the wedding noted that he was the first Cushing son-in-law who was not socially prominent. Babe was the perfect wife for a domineering husband. Unlike Bill's previous wife, Babe was groomed to serve a man without complaint. Her own mother taught her to suppress her feelings, always have composure and never say anything negative about your husband or about anyone for that matter. And that's what she did throughout her 31 years of marriage to William S. Paley. Babe was always attentive to Bill, paying close attention to his moods and his needs, giving up any sense of autonomy. She went so far as to stop setting her hair before bed because he didn't want her doing her hair at night. Bill liked to have attractive people around, and Babe's life was spent hosting Cafe Society-like dinner parties, where her sole role was to be the decorative presence. Not necessarily silent, but by all means, to be seen. Even as Bill expected Babe to be perfect, and she worked hard to devote herself to meeting his demanding standards, his expectations scarcely afforded any consideration for the toll it took to maintain appearances. In spite of it all, Babe Paley excelled as a gracious hostess, going to great lengths to ensure her guests were content. With meticulous organization, she made sure no one had to unpack, and every bedroom was filled with provisions like food, flowers, and newspapers. According to their friend Lady Mary Dunn, you could hardly get into the bedroom for the flowers. Over time, the marriage became a waking nightmare for Babe, with Bill's ever-increasing demands and wandering eye further eroding their relationship. In All His Glory, Sally Bedell Smith paints William Paley as a hard-driving narcissist who treated his children much as he dealt with his top executives. What counted was that they knew he was in charge. He applied the same rule to his wife. So much so that Babe lived in fear of her husband's bad temper. Smith pushes the point home with the story of the broken lamp. Once, when a floor lamp got damaged, Bill demanded that it be fixed on the double. While Babe was trying to get it repaired, she had to leave with Bill for a trip to Europe. When they arrived back in the States, Babe was so nervous about the lamp that she called her sister from the airport to find out if the repairs had been done. When Betsy reported that they had not, Babe begged her to run over and get it out of the house. "I don't care what you do with it, just get it out of his sight before Bill sees it." Another time, Babe expressed fear of Bill was when she told her friend Truman Capote about a recent love affair. As Smith tells it, one day Babe invited Capote to an out-of-the-way New York restaurant to meet the man she loved, an American ambassador. He was charming and devoted, but soon afterward she ended the affair, telling Capote she was afraid Bill would find out. It was better to be alone. Never mind that Bill was a notorious womanizer and had multitudes of affairs. He was a philanderer with a roving eye and groping hands that just couldn't get enough beautiful and accomplished women into his bed. His affairs included all manner of women, including many well-known socialites and even his own American diplomat. He was also said to have had encounters with actresses including Greta Garbo, Peggy Knudsen, and Louise Brooks. Bill's infidelities brought Babe's insecurities to light. She started to believe that she wasn't attractive to men or attractive at all. She ultimately resigned herself to a barren marriage bed, while her friends speculated she might be asexual. Truman Capote, Babe's closest friend and confidant, wrote in an excerpt from his unfinished book, Answered Prayers, that Babe tried to kill herself multiple times, once by cutting her wrists and the other by taking a handful of pills. But the book is, in actuality, only a work of fiction characterized by thinly veiled representations of the socialites he called his swans, including his most revered swan, Babe Paley. Capote was prone to exaggeration and had no qualms about writing and telling half-truths about what he saw and heard during his years as part of the New York Cafe Society, leaving us with the question if it was actually true that Babe contemplated taking her own life. He also claimed that Babe confessed to him that she had considered divorce several times in the marriage and that he talked her out of it by reminding her that Bill bought and paid for her. Playing upon her ever-present insecurities, Capote pointed out that she had no money of her own, had four children, and couldn't maintain her social status if she were to ruin it all by becoming a sad divorcee left to live on the fringes of society. Also from Truman Capote, we get the story that Babe had a little gold notebook that she used to make notes about her inadequacies, in an effort to do better the next time that she hosted a soiree or dinner party. Once perceived as nothing less than perfect, the drive to perfectionism only made life with Bill Paley that much more difficult. Babe Paley's marriage was tragic, not only because of who her husband was and what he did inside the marriage, but also because of Babe's need to be perfect at the detriment of her own happiness. It was this need to appear perfect that ultimately alienated Truman Capote from his beautiful Babe. In La Côte Basque, Capote exposed Bill Paley's infidelities with a crude storyline that both embarrassed and appalled Babe. She knew that the world now saw the cracks in her marriage and that she was, after all, less than perfect. Babe Paley never forgave Truman and succumbed to cancer a few years later, never having spoken to him ever again. There is another swan that never forgave Capote after the publication of La Côte Basque. In fact, there are those who say that her death was a direct result of the malice that Capote felt for her. In the glittering world of New York high society, where glamour and wealth seemed to reign supreme, Anne Woodward's life was destined for both greatness and tragedy. Her story, which unfolded like a dark and twisted fairy tale, offers a glimpse into the secrets and scandals hidden behind the painted smiles of the elite. The notorious murder of her millionaire husband would haunt Anne Woodward for the next 20 years and culminate in her death when Truman Capote, the master of the true crime novel, brutally shined the spotlight on what was known as the shooting of the century. In this chapter, we will look at the life of Anne Woodward, who she was, how she came to fame, and her brutal takedown by the man she once thought was a friend. Born as Evangeline Crowell in 1915 in a small Kansas town, Anne Woodward had dreams bigger than her humble beginnings. At the age of 23, she arrived in New York City, shedding her birth name and adopting the moniker Anne Eden. Her striking beauty soon caught the attention of the influential John Robert Powers Agency, propelling her into the world of modeling and entertainment. Her journey appeared to be the beginning of a classic Hollywood success story. But Anne was about to discover that her ascent came with a price. Anne's early years in New York brought her some success as a radio actress. With her radiant beauty, she earned the ironic title of the most beautiful girl in radio. However, her climb to fame was arduous. In her mid-20s, she found herself working as a showgirl at a nightclub catering to the city's affluent and influential men. It was here that Anne's destiny took an unexpected turn. William Woodward Sr., a wealthy banker from an old money family, walked into the nightclub, changing the course of Anne's life forever. Turns out that good old William Woodward Sr. was searching for a bit more excitement than his marriage could provide. Anne's mesmerizing presence on stage left him spellbound. She exuded charisma and uninhibited confidence. Whether she was provocatively dancing under the spotlight or mingling with the patrons in her bunny suit. She stood in stark contrast to the women in his social circle, and he found it impossible to resist her. That was until his wife got wind of their affair. Rumors were going around that Anne had become William Sr.'s mistress, and it was time to put a stop to it all. It wasn't long after that when William Woodward Sr. broke it to Anne that he needed to terminate their not-so-secret affair. Still, he wanted to keep her close by, so it dawned on him to devise a cunning plan. He put it to Anne that she might employ her seductive charms on, guess who? His very own son, William Woodward Jr. Despite society's current fascination with young Billy's bachelor status, it appeared that he had no interest in pursuing a romantic relationship. Woodward Sr. suspected that his son might be inexperienced in matters of romance, and he had even heard whispers suggesting that Billy might be homosexual, which he found unacceptable for his family's reputation. Anne, perhaps, could impart some wisdom about women to his son and guide him in a different direction. Anne readily agreed to the proposition. If she couldn't have the father, she was more than willing to accept the son. All of which set the stage for a series of events that would lead to tragedy. When Anne first hooked up with the young Billy, everyone thought she wasn't good enough for him. William Jr.'s mother promptly branded Anne as a gold digger and encouraged her son to end their relationship. Regardless, William Woodward Jr. married Evangeline Crowell, aka Anne Eden, on March 20, 1943, but much to her dismay, the elite circles of New York high society outright rejected her, leaving her isolated from the glittering parties and social events she had aspired to attend. Undeterred by the icy reception, Anne persevered. She immersed herself in the intricacies of upper-class decorum, acquiring the manners, fashion sense, and references required to navigate the city's social elite, but to no avail. Anne had hoped to be accepted into a very elite group of women known as Truman Capote's swans, including Babe Paley, Gloria Guinness, and Slim Keith, to name a few. But even as she produced two sons as heirs to the Woodward fortune, the swans kept her on the fringes of their orbit. Some say it was because of her humble beginnings and early days as a showgirl. Or perhaps, the swans had an inkling of the spotlight that Anne would later put on everyone in the group when Truman Capote brutally used Anne to promote his upcoming book, Answered Prayers. And in the process, he betrayed them all. But don't let me get ahead of myself. Near the end of the 1940s, Anne's marriage began to deteriorate. Petty fights and public arguments plagued the couple. Behind closed doors, both Anne and Billy engaged in extramarital affairs, intensifying their conflicts. By 1955, Billy made the final decision that divorce was his only option. Anne faced a difficult choice when Billy said he was done for good and good riddance to her. Despite the turmoil in their marriage, she couldn't bear to lose her social status and the life she had fought so hard to attain. Anne refused his plea, unknowingly setting the stage for a tragic turn of events. As Anne's emotional burden grew heavier, she sought solace in martinis and prescription pills, and while that might have contributed to what happened on that fateful night, it wasn't the main event. The story goes like this. In the eerie backdrop of Halloween 1955, Anne and Billy were attending a party hosted by their friends, the Duke of Windsor and Wallace Simpson. During dinner, they discussed a recent string of burglaries in their neighborhood, voicing their determination to protect their home and property at all cost. Their fears took a dark turn when Billy revealed that he kept a weapon near his bedside, and Anne confessed to having one as well. Later that night, as Anne lay in her separate bedroom, her dog's frantic barking signaled danger. Convinced that a burglar was in their home, she heard noises on the roof and rushed to investigate. Armed with a shotgun, she confronted the intruder outside Billy's bedroom door and fired a fatal shot. When authorities arrived at the scene at 2:35 a.m., they discovered a harrowing tableau. Anne cradled her husband's lifeless body, sobbing and crying, "I shot him." To their shock, they found that the so-called intruder was none other than her husband, Billy. Anne had inadvertently taken her husband's life under the guise of mistaken identity, or so she claimed. In the aftermath of the shooting, Anne's behavior raised suspicions. She made cryptic statements, and her lawyer, Sol Rosenblatt, was soon on the scene to shield her from extensive questioning. The press seized upon the case, dubbing it the shooting of the century. However, a shocking turn of events would soon cast doubt on Anne's culpability. It turns out that a man named Paul Wirths, known for burglary, claimed he had attempted to break into the Woodward residence on the night of the shooting. This revelation appeared to exonerate Anne, but it also deepened the already wide rift with her mother-in-law, Elise, who remained convinced of Anne's guilt. Soon after, in a scene that mirrored a courtroom drama, Anne found herself facing a grand jury trial for the alleged murder of her own husband. Within the Nassau County Courthouse, a disheveled Anne passionately proclaimed her innocence, insisting once more that she had mistakenly believed Billy was an intruder. She even pointed out that the actual burglar had been apprehended. Nevertheless, the prosecution did not shy away from bringing up her troubled marriage and, undoubtedly, the substantial inheritance she stood to gain if Billy were no longer in the picture. When the verdict was finally delivered, it set tongues wagging. After a mere 30 minutes of deliberation, the jury reached a controversial decision, acquitting Anne Woodward of all charges on the grounds of self-defense, but the public wasn't buying it. Many remained skeptical of her innocence, and new theories popped up, including one that claimed Anne was set free thanks to the mother-in-law who was said to have devised the whole story of another man in the house and that she had paid him to take the rap for Anne. The reasoning was to spare the Woodward family name and get Anne out of the limelight. Anne's reputation was tarnished, and her high society friends turned their backs on her. Banished from New York high society at the command of her mother-in-law to get out of town, Anne sought refuge abroad. She wandered through European cities, drowning her sorrows in Venice and elsewhere. However, her exile came at a tremendous cost. Anne's two sons, Woody and Jimmy, were sent to boarding school in Switzerland, with no explanations provided. Her youngest, Jimmy, faced his own demons, succumbing to addiction and mental turmoil after serving in Vietnam. Anne attempted to re-enter the New York social scene, but her efforts were in vain. She had lost her power, and her looks were fading. Her tragic tale had one final twist when she encountered Truman Capote, who knew Anne but was never close with her. They were connected via friends of friends at best. In the book Deliberate Cruelty, author Roseanne Montillo writes, "As he arrived at the table, Anne immediately got up from her chair, angry that she should have been disturbed during her meal. A short conversation followed, during which, apparently, Anne called Truman a little fag. He returned the slur by wagging his finger at her and calling her Mrs. Bang Bang, a moniker that would stick to her for the rest of her days." Truman gossiped about the encounter for years afterward. When word got back to Anne that Capote was talking about her, she called him a little toad. A ball of hatred grew in Truman Capote, so much so that Anne became the target of the famous author's caustic wit over the next two decades. By 1975, Capote not only hated Anne, but some suggest that he began to resent his infamous swans, the wealthy and socially prominent women who were his close friends and who he had worked so hard at becoming their loyal and trusted confidant. Over the years, they had spoon-fed Truman Capote their darkly hidden secrets, their tormented feelings, and their deepest desires. The writer encouraged them to spill it all out, all the while he was taking notes and waiting patiently to strike, just like a snake in the grass. In November 1975, Truman Capote published a preview chapter of a book that he was working on that was going to expose everything and everybody. Those very women who he had courted and befriended. And he wasn't going to forget that one woman that he hated so vehemently, Anne Woodward. The article was called La Côte Basque 1965, and in it he used thinly veiled characters to represent his swans along with Anne Woodward. Capote's portrayal of Anne in Lecoq Basque was nothing short of brutal. He depicted her as Anne Hopkins, a jazzy little carrot-top killer and a malicious Betty Grable who had murdered her husband for financial gain. He also gave away a bedroom secret by giving his fictional Anne the nickname Lady Marmalade, because of a little trick she'd learned to do with jam. Whether these claims had any basis in reality was unclear, but the damage was done. Capote's words published in Esquire further tarnished Anne's already fragile reputation. Anne never got to witness the publication of Lecoq Basque. In October 1975, overwhelmed by her tragic fate and the impending publication, she sadly took her own life at the early age of 59. Babe Paley and Anne Woodward weren't the only New York socialites whose lives were altered when Truman Capote betrayed their secrets to all of the world. Some continued to reign supreme atop the social ladder. Others encountered a tragic descent from grace when their meticulously cultivated veneers were so harshly shattered. In this chapter, we will take a look at what happened to other swans in the aftermath of Capote's expose, beginning with Slim Keith. Like Babe, Slim was prominently depicted in the article, Lecoq Basque, 1965, that was published in Esquire magazine in the year 1975. Speculations abound that she served as the inspiration for the character Lady Coolbirth in Capote's narrative, a divorcee known for her various pursuits of new husbands who need only be wealthy and technically alive. Born Nancy Ray Gross, Slim's foray into Hollywood society commenced at the age of 17 when she abandoned formal education in favor of a modeling career and acquired the stage name, Slim, all thanks to the actor William Powell, who she met while staying at the Furnace Creek Inn and Ranch Resort. Through Powell, she was introduced to William Randolph Hearst and his companion Marion Davies. She thus became a Hollywood socialite and was frequently seen at parties with Gary Cooper and Cary Grant. It was Hearst, the titan of Hearst Communications, who helped turn her into a major fashion icon of the 1950s and 1960s. At 22, she graced the cover of Harper's Bazaar and was a recurrent presence over the years on the magazine's coveted best-dressed list. Slim captivated the attention of numerous suitors, including Clark Gable. However, her affections ultimately led her to acclaimed director Howard Hawks, who she met in 1938. Hawks was immediately smitten with her and did everything he could to persuade Slim to marry him, which she did in 1941. The couple welcomed a baby girl named Kitty, and shortly thereafter, she left Hawks because he was unable to remain faithful, embarking on a romance with theater producer Leland Hayward. After 10 years of marriage, Hayward tragically dumped Slim for socialite Pamela Churchill. I say tragically because Slim proclaimed in her memoir that he had been the love of her life. She went on to marry a third time to British banker Kenneth Keith in 1962, which culminated in separation in 1972. No luck in marital bliss for this lady. Following Capote's alienation, Slim banished him from her life, like many of the other swans. Vanity Fair reported that she even consulted a lawyer about suing Capote for libel when, as Lady Coolbirth, she was painted as someone who delights in dishing about everyone from the British royal family to her dearest friends. The last years of her life were spent pursuing travel and living in quiet solitude in New York City, where she penned her memoir, Slim, Memories of a Rich and Imperfect Life, in 1990. An inveterate smoker, Slim Keith died at age 72 of lung cancer at New York Hospital. Next, we have Lee Radziwill, one of the few New York socialites who stayed friends with Capote and even defended him after his betrayal. Beyond her status as a New York City socialite, Lee bore the distinction of being the younger sibling of former First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis. Born Caroline Lee Bouvier on March 3, 1933, to stockbroker John Verneau Bouvier and socialite Janet Norton Lee, young Lee resided in a palatial 12-room duplex on 740 Park Avenue in Manhattan. Following a celebrated debut punctuated by a resplendent full-page feature in a December 1950 issue of Life magazine, Lee eagerly integrated herself into New York's elite social culture. Lee attempted brief forays into acting, including roles in the 1967 play The Philadelphia Story in Chicago, and a subsequent television movie called Laura. But when she received a devastatingly tepid reception, she decided it was better to give it all up and turn her attention towards a career as a fashion icon and socialite. As for marriage, her first was with American diplomat Michael Temple Canfield in 1953, which dissolved in 1958, followed by a marriage to Prince Stanislaw Stas Radziwill in 1959, resulting in the birth of two children, Anthony and Anna. A serendipitous luncheon encounter in 1962 precipitated Lee's bond with Capote, leading to a profound friendship. Lee was often photographed while mingling with Hollywood's most elite and even went on tour with the Rolling Stones at one point with her new close friend Capote. Sadly, the late 1960s also brought personal turmoil for Lee, exacerbated by her envy towards her older sister Jackie, who was, at that time, married to the President of the United States, Jack Kennedy. Added to that, her jealousy only got stronger when Jackie was widowed by the president's assassination, and 5 years later married one of the world's richest and most famous men, shipping magnate Aristotle Onassis in 1968. In his book Capote's Women, Lawrence Lehmer writes this about Lee. She was consumed with jealousy. It was all she could think about, all she could talk about. Her sister had done nothing wrong, but that did not matter. Jackie had transcended Lee in a manner that, in Lee's eyes, was destroying her life. She had what almost anyone would say was everything, more than everything, yet she was so dissatisfied, so empty, so lost. Lee's marriage to the prince also came to an end in 1974, and even when Capote used her jealousy of her sister and her failed marriage in his published article in 1975, Lee was one of the few to stay friends with him. She actually defended him over subsequent years, saying, "I just don't think he realized what he was doing because, God, did he pay for it? That's what put him back to serious drinking. And then, of course, the terrible fear that he could never write another word again. It was all downhill from then on." But cracks in their relationship began to grow when she invited him to her stunning country house in England. And as she recounted, he broke most of the furniture in the guest house. Her refusal to testify in Capote's defense during a 1979 slander lawsuit, Truman Capote versus Gore Vidal, further strained their bond. Capote had expected Lee to support him, but she shocked him by signing an affidavit for Vidal, stating that she did not recall ever discussing with Truman the incident or the evening in question. Capote, in turn, publicly expressed his anger and called her treacherous for not telling the truth and for deserting him during his struggle against alcohol and pills. In her later years, Lee gained acclaim for her interior design prowess, launching her own firm in 1976 and authoring two books. She was also named by Vanity Fair as the best dressed in 1996. A third marriage, to actor Herbert Ross in 1988, culminated in dissolution in 2001. The untimely death of her son Anthony, juxtaposed with the tragic loss of her nephew John F. Kennedy Jr. in 1999, marked a somber chapter in Lee Radziwill's life. She passed away at age 85 on February 15, 2019, in her Upper East Side home. And now we have two lesser-known socialites who were also fictionally skewered in that infamous article. Both had long and very close friendships with Capote. One forgave him, the other could not. They were Gloria Vanderbilt, who you may have heard of, and her childhood friend, Carol Mathau, who had a longer relationship with Truman Capote than any of the Swans portrayed in the 2024 FX series, Feud, Capote versus the Swans. And while they are not included in the repertoire of Swans in the FX series, their lives were still juicy enough to provide Capote with the necessary gossip fodder needed to shock and awe his readers. "All literature is gossip," Truman told Playboy magazine in defense of his thinly veiled characterizations. In La Côte Basque, 1965, Truman Capote depicts Gloria Vanderbilt and Carol Mathau as Gloria Vanderbilt de Chico Stokowski Lumet Cooper and her childhood chum, Carol Marcus Saroyan. She married him twice. Mathau, Women in their late 30s, but looking not much removed from those Deb days when they were grabbing lucky balloons at the Stork Club. In his excerpt article, Truman portrays them as empty, vain socialites whose lives are desperately unfulfilled. They are so bored with their overprivileged lives that during their luncheon at La Côte Basque, Gloria Vanderbilt's character, going by the name Mrs. Cooper, recounted the strange suicide of a friend of J.D. Salinger's who died passed out and drunk in the snow. Carol Matthau's character replied, "That is a strange story. It must have been lovely, though, all warm with whiskey drifting off into the cold, starry air." He expands upon their vapid lives as days where they are hammered and nights are spent in a prescription pill fugue, turning their brains to mashed vegetables intended to escape the pain of unhappy marriages and the tedium of extreme wealth. So gone is Gloria Vanderbilt at the luncheon that she fails to recognize her first husband, Pat DeChicco, when he greets her and tells her she is more beautiful than ever. "Who was that?" she asks her friend Carol. "You didn't recognize him, did you?" she replied. "Once upon a time, you thought very highly of him. You cooked his meals and washed his socks, and when he was in the army, you followed him from camp to camp, living in dreary furnished rooms. That, Gloria, was your first husband." Gloria Vanderbilt was the penultimate, poor little rich girl. She was born in 1924 bearing the prestigious name of Vanderbilt, bestowed upon her by her parents, Reginald Claypool Vanderbilt and his second wife, Gloria Morgan. When the young Gloria was a mere 18 months old, Reginald succumbed to cirrhosis. Following his death, his young widow became the administrator of a $2.5 million trust that Reginald left to their daughter. After a court granted $4,000 per month for young Gloria's care, Morgan reportedly squandered the cash partying around the world, eventually losing custody of the child and her vast fortune to her sister-in-law, Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney, in what was then dubbed the Trial of the Century. During her adolescent years, Vanderbilt ventured into the world of modeling and immersed herself in the glamorous lifestyle of Hollywood, purportedly engaging in romantic dalliances with the likes of the notorious Errol Flynn and the enigmatic Howard Hughes. When only 17, she exchanged vows with her first husband, Pasquale DeChicco, a Hollywood agent. They divorced 4 years later. Before the ink had dried on her divorce from DeChicco, she embarked on a romantic journey with her second husband, the conductor Leopold Stokowski, who she married in 1945. She was just 21 to his 63. Together, they bore sons Stanley and Christopher and remained married for a decade. Following their separation, she was rumored to have dated the music icon Frank Sinatra and the screen legend Marlon Brando before tying the knot with director Sidney Lumet in 1956. Their marriage dissolved in 1963. After parting ways with her third husband, Gloria met her fourth and final husband, the writer Wyatt Cooper, who she married in 1963, later referring to this union as her only happy marriage. With Cooper, she bore two sons, Anderson and Carter. Tragically, Wyatt Cooper succumbed to complications during heart surgery in 1978, 3 years after La Côte Basque, and her son Carter tragically took his own life a decade later. Gloria Vanderbilt once described Capote as a marvelous friend, highlighting his wit and charm. However, when she read the characterization of her in the Esquire article, she supposedly said, "The next time I see Truman Capote, I'm going to spit in his face." Her son, CNN journalist and newscaster Anderson Cooper, has said in recent years, "I think Truman really hurt my mother." As far as we know, Gloria Vanderbilt never forgave Truman his crass representation of her as a pill-popping socialite, unlike her childhood friend Carol Matthau, who, by the way, was also a good friend of a young Truman Capote from the age of 13. They met at a dance school in New York and stayed in touch right up until his death in 1984. Carol wrote in her memoir, "At 3 every morning that I was in New York, I would meet Truman at a private club called the Gold Key Club on West 55th Street. The lights were low and we would sit in big chairs in front of a fireplace and talk and talk. Even when we'd been on different continents, I was never not in touch with him, either by phone or note. In addition, Carol states that her personality, not her job, was the inspiration for Capote's character, Holly Golightly, the heroine of his 1958 novella, Breakfast at Tiffany's. Carol considered Capote both a friend and a source of frustration, having once said of him, "Truman was a monster of selfishness, but he was also a genius." Carol Mathau was born Carol Grace Marcus on September 11, 1924, in New York City's Lower East Side. She had a bleak childhood spent in foster homes until the age of 8, when she was rescued via her mother's second marriage to a co-founder of the Bendix Corporation and relocated to an 18-room apartment on Fifth Avenue. There she made fast friends with a debutante set, including Gloria Vanderbilt, who would remain lifelong friends and secure her a place alongside, but never squarely in, the elite circle of Capote's swans. Still, she was undeniably suited to spend her life among the rich and famous. Carol twice married and divorced Pulitzer Prize-winning writer William Saroyan, with whom she had two children. She began her career as a model, gracing the covers of prestigious magazines and catching the eye of Hollywood directors. Her beauty and charm soon transitioned her into acting, where she displayed her versatility in both comedic and dramatic roles. In 1955, she met stage actor Walter Matthau, and the two married in 1959. Together, they became a fixture in Hollywood circles, known for their lively parties and entertaining anecdotes. Throughout her life, Carol was a celebrated socialite in both New York and Hollywood. She was the muse and confidant to some of the 20th century's most renowned writers, including Truman Capote, the witness to high society galas of the 40s, the guest at and host of glitzy Hollywood dinner parties throughout the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, and a frequent attendee at the Oscars and the White House. Unlike Gloria Vanderbilt, Carol easily forgave Truman for his portrayal of her in La Côte Basque. She attended his funeral and wrote in her memoir, Among the Porcupines, "It was an abomination to hear people who barely knew Truman speaking of him. I remember one man describing the high point of Truman's life as the black and white ball, an unthinkable thing to say about a man as serious and brilliant as Truman. I know that there will be all sorts of things said about Truman for a long time, and then everything will settle, and what will be left will be his work. I think that will endure, because of his very special gift of simultaneous lightness and depth." Carol remained Truman Capote's friend until his death. She passed away on July 20th, 2003, at the age of 78. So now that we have covered the many players involved in that fateful feud that started when Capote published La Côte Basque in 1975, you might, at this point, be wondering about other chapters and the rest of Capote's unfinished novel. Truman Capote envisioned his unfinished novel, Answered Prayers, as a large, sprawling story that spanned 30 years, moved between two continents, and included a vast and influential company of players. According to Capote, the title is taken from a quote by Saint Teresa of Avila: "More tears are shed over answered prayers than unanswered ones," although there is no authentic record that Saint Teresa ever made such a statement. The first chapter of Truman Capote's unfinished novel, titled Unspoiled Monsters, was published in Esquire magazine in May 1976. The publication of this chapter, along with three others that contained thinly veiled characters based on real people, caused a significant uproar and backlash among Truman Capote's social circle, leading to strained relationships and ostracism. True to form, upon its publication, Capote posed for the cover as an assassin, holding a stiletto. Capote allegedly teased friends with that wry smile of his, saying that if they were not careful, he would put them in his book. He described the book in People magazine as being like a gun. There's the handle, the trigger, the barrel, and finally the bullet. And when that bullet is fired from the gun, it's going to come out with a speed and power like you've never seen. The other published chapters of Truman Capote's unfinished novel published in Esquire magazine are Mojave, published June 1975, La Côte Basque, 1965, published November 1975, and Kate McLeod, published December 1976. Despite the publication of these excerpts, the complete novel was never finished, and its final fate remains a subject of mystery and speculation and loads of theories to this day. And that is what this video is about. All the many theories, truths, and half-truths about what really did or didn't happen to Answered Prayers. For now, I'll start with a commonly held theory that Truman Capote never wrote any more of Answered Prayers, following the 1976 Esquire chapters, having fallen into a deep despair, abusing alcohol and drugs until his death 8 years later. This is what Jack Dunphy, Capote's longtime companion, believed. Even though Capote pretended publicly right up until his death to be working hard on the book, he was simply unable to finish his work. I'm very glad that Truman did not live to see Answered Prayers published. It would have broken his heart, said Jack Dunphy. In 1987, author George Plimpton assembled an oral biography of Capote that was filled with the theories and ideas and purported experiences of those who knew him. This biography, titled Truman Capote, in which various friends, enemies, acquaintances, and detractors recall his turbulent career, provided insights into Capote's life and the challenges he faced during the creation of his unfinished novel, speculating about what happened to Answered Prayers. Norman Mailer, one of Capote's greatest literary enemies, surmised that the book probably died in him years earlier. Mailer understood the elite society that Capote sought to expose in his desire to exact revenge on the beautiful people who had seduced him, thereby distracting him from his work. In Mailer's mind, New York society had swallowed his talent. He likened Capote to a little Napoleon who believed that writing his ultimate masterpiece would increase his prestige among the jet set, but he didn't understand the true social force of New York, that even he could be kicked to the curb. He just wasn't strong enough to say, "A plague on your house," and write the book he could write. Another enemy, Gore Vidal, scoffed at the idea that Capote could ever have succeeded in his ambitions, saying he simply didn't have the kind of concentration it would take to write anything more than just a gossip novel of the lowest nature. When the unpublished version of Capote's Answered Prayers was eventually published by Random House, Capote's editor, Joseph Fox, wrote a note to the publication saying that he believes that there is a possibility that Capote did write as many as 4 more chapters, but that they did not live up to his hopes for them. So he deliberately destroyed them during the final years of his life when he was almost incoherent because of drugs or alcohol or both. Capote's friend, Joe Petrichik, recalled an evening in Sag Harbor when Capote got up in front of them and read sections from a chapter entitled A Severe Insult to the Brain, a vignette about a gay man named Jerry Zipkin, a real estate heir, social escort, and friend of Nancy Reagan. The title is a reference to death by alcoholism. But Petrichik admitted that he was never sure whether or not Truman was just telling me the story. He had pages in front of him which he was apparently reading. He would look up, he was quite the actor, and I never did actually see the words on paper. Author John Knowles claimed that he did see physical pages from the rest of Answered Prayers, but years later Capote told him in Southampton that he'd come to believe none of it was any good. "I don't know," Knowles said. "I think he burned hundreds and hundreds of pages." But director Frank Perry told another story. "I asked him how everything was going, and he said, 'It's wonderful. Look at that, finished pages, 2.5 inches, it's wonderful.'" Perry wasn't sure he could believe him, so he drifted over to riffle through the manuscript only to discover that the top 3 pages had typewriting on them and the rest were blank. Alan Schwartz, Capote's literary executor, recalled that Capote had tried many times to get Random House to pay him more of his advance, claiming that the novel was basically done. Given that they did fork over a lot of money, Schwartz was absolutely astounded to find no trace of the missing chapters after Capote's death. At one time, Clay Felker, the founder of New York Magazine, had offered Capote $35,000 for the next excerpt from the book. Capote had spent the entire morning at his house recounting one chapter in lurid detail. He said he'd give it to him that weekend, but Capote later backed out. He met Felker again and began to describe a whole different part of the book, a suicide that Kate McLeod witnesses. "I just have to tighten a few screws," he said. Felker claims he would have paid even $100,000 for the chapter, but Capote never delivered it. Everyone accepted that Capote was known to exaggerate and to lie. He was also a mess during the years after the publication of La Côte Basque. John Knowles recounted how Capote once lost $4,000 worth of cocaine in his front yard and later got so inebriated that he fell out of bed 15 times in one night. Knowles witnessed Truman having hallucinations and drug-related seizures. Once, Knowles said, he walked into traffic and nearly was run over by a bus. "I think he just decided, I'm going to be stoned all the time and die without writing another word." The literary executor, Alan Schwartz, recalls that at one point Capote asserted to him that the novel was finished and that his former lover, John O'Shea, had stolen it and taken it to Florida in the trunk of his car. Capote asked Schwartz to file a lawsuit demanding the return of the pages. Later, Truman claimed to have gone down to Florida and personally blown up O'Shea's car. He said, "One day, little Johnny went downstairs and his car wasn't there. Instead, there was a big puddle where a car used to be." Nobody believed Capote did any such thing. Producer Lester Persky claimed for a long time to have the manuscript locked in a drawer in his house he couldn't open. When he and Schwartz finally did pry it open, there was nothing there. Then there was Joanne Carson, ex-wife of Johnny Carson and one of Truman's female friends. Not really a swan, but a close confidant. She said that Capote gave her a key to a safe deposit box on the morning of his death, but that there was no number on the key, and furthermore, she had no idea what box, in what bank, or even in what city it belonged to. She claims to have read firsthand three of the chapters from the unfinished manuscript. She described them in some detail to George Plimpton, who says that he then personally went to Alan Schwartz to ask about the safe deposit key. Schwartz confirmed there was a key, but even as they tried to track it everywhere, they never found any possible safe deposit box or anything else it might open. Capote's favorite story about the location of answered prayers was that he had locked it up at the Greyhound station in Los Angeles, but apparently the key had no connection to the bus station. In 1971, 4 years before Capote released the Esquire chapters, he appeared on the Dick Cavett Show and jokingly said that the book would be his posthumous novel. "Either I'm going to kill it, or it is going to kill me." More recently, researchers from Vanity Fair stumbled across an unfinished manuscript of another chapter meant for answered prayers entitled "Yachts and Things" among Capote's papers at the New York Public Library. The 6 typewritten and hand-edited pages were published by Vanity Fair in December 2012 and can be read in its entirety on the Vanity Fair website in their archives. I left a link below for your reading pleasure, and any thanks that you want to throw in the comments, I'll be happy to receive. This long-lost chapter had been sitting at the New York Public Library for more than 2 decades. It makes you wonder if Truman had been hiding parts of his infamous novel Answered Prayers right under our noses all this time. Thanks for watching, and feel free to subscribe for more historical videos.